Alright, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and this is one that you guys have requested, actually. One of the videos I did, I think, last summer, I kind of showed you guys in my garden. I showed you guys my pepper harvest when I actually did trials, and I tried two worm castings side by side. I tried the Organic Garden Solutions worm castings on one half of my bed, and I tried the Worm Gold Plus on the other half. These are two of the top worm castings that I found out there. And until then, you know, Worm Gold Plus was my de facto standard, like the only one I'd like to use because I thought it was so good. But, you know, comparing it to the Organic Gardening Solution casting, I had like twice the growth, twice the harvest, and I was just growing bell peppers. Imagine if you're growing, you know, other valuable crops. And bell peppers, actually, they're a quite valuable crop, you know. Sometimes, depending on the season, organic bell peppers can be $5, $6, $7, $8 a pound, depending on where you live. So I want to encourage you guys to, you know, grow foods and grow crops that are high value so that, you know, you're growing and maximizing the use of your limited space if you guys have limited space like I do. Anyways, in that video, like so many people thumbs it up. Actually, I made a special trip. I drove for hours to get here. I'm actually in Camarillo, California, and I'm at the home of Organic Solutions, and they make those organic solution worm castings that I had amazing results with. And what I thought I'd do in this episode is actually show you guys how easy it is to make your own worm castings, some of the specific ingredients they use, and I'll try to get the recipe out of the owner here. I don't know if he's going to disclose it, but he's going to let me share the ingredients he uses and my tips along the way on how he creates some of the best worm castings so that you guys could do it too, right? I believe that, you know, as much as his worm castings are good and I use his worm castings, I'll be the first to say, because I don't want to sit there and make my own. You know, you guys are free to make your own, and I encourage you, actually, guys, to make your own if you have time and some space to dedicate to taking care of some worms, because they are living creatures and we should treat them really nice and keep them in an environment so that they can live and thrive. I've seen so many people get, you know, worm bin or whatever, and they kind of neglect it and the worms lose their lives, and it's kind of sad when that happens, right? Or you could kind of be like me, right? And what I might do, actually, after this video is in my raised beds, I seed worms. So I put like pounds of worms in my raised beds, so they're always in my raised beds working. And actually, in my raised beds, actually, I feed some of the similar nutrients that he actually feeds here, minus a few of them, actually. So then basically, my worms are working inside my raised beds without even being in bins, right? So I think that's really the best solution. Get some worms, put really good stuff in your soil so the worms could eat it, break it down, and turn it into castings where you need it the most, right in your raised beds. Anyways, we're here at Organic Solution outside, and we're gonna go ahead and head inside Organic Solution today and share with you guys the whole process it takes to make some of the world's best worm castings I found. Just wanted to take a moment out of this episode today to remind you guys that we're still doing, for a limited time, the Growing Your Greens t-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens t-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens t-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below, compassiontees.com. Link is also at the end of this video. So when you're done watching the video, click over and support me while you still can, and also get a cool organic t-shirt at the same time. So the first thing that you gotta know if you're gonna be keeping worms not in your raised bed like I do, or in your garden, or, you know, in your farm, is you gotta have a place to keep the worms where they're gonna have a nice life, a nice environment, or a home that they could live in, right? And they've tried many different methods of raising worms here at Organic Solutions, and what they tried first was like this kind of thing. This is a flow-through bed. So basically it's a big bed with walls, and it's like open on the bottom, and basically worms would be in there, then all the castings would fall out. And they quickly found, for what they do specifically, this was not working for them. I know a lot of commercial worm farms use a maybe system similar to this, but this did not work for them. Also, you know, a system like this can actually get quite expensive, had to get custom built and all this kind of stuff. So they found a much more economical system that's actually a lot more easily scalable, you know, to grow the worms and the worm castings on a large scale. So let me go ahead and show you the other side of the pathway here on what they're using. So instead, what they decided to use is a standard produce tub. So these are like harvest bins, you know, when they're harvesting produce in the fields or whatnot. Produce is often shipped in these. Sometimes they're shipped in ones that are cardboard about this size, but they're using the plastic ones here. And if you note, the plastic ones have nice little holes in there for aeration. They have holes in the bottom too. And so this is a good environment to keep the worms. I mean, if you guys want to keep worms in a smaller area of your house instead of using one of these big things, which might not be a bad idea if you want to have a nice big bed of worms, you could just get a Rubbermaid tote from like Walmart or Target and like, you know, drill holes to have some aeration and ventilation in there. And so, yeah, so they just basically use these big totes, and you know, their farm currently has in production with the worms in it approximately 100 of these totes, and they're gonna scale this up once they get enough and grow enough worms to around 300 to produce a lot of worm castings here on this farm. Another consideration is that they don't own the land here where they're you know, producing the worm casting, so everything that they've created here on site is all completely modular, so they could actually pick all this stuff up and move it to another location, you know, should they need or should they want to. But yeah, and then these guys could just be picked up, forklifts, they could be dumped out, and all that kind of stuff. So the first thing, aside from the place that the worms are going to live, is the most important thing is actually the bedding the worms will live in. Many people might use coconut core, shredded newspaper, something like that. But, you know, here at Organic Solution, they use a functional bedding, a bedding that the worms could live in, but not only live in, but also eat, and they'll thrive in. So let me go ahead and show you guys that bedding and the main source of their food next. So the main bedding and food source for the worms is this stuff right here. You guys can see a big pile of compost, but it's not any old compost. This compost does not have any food scraps, which is actually what most people feed their worms, right? Having worms digest food scraps takes a long time. So by feeding them already broken down materials, and this actually comes from landscapers, so you know, trees shredded up, you know, and leaves and things and bark mixed in, that's what they're using primarily, local sourced. And they have a compost thermometer in there. Today it's about 120 degrees, so this is an active compost pile. So basically they're feeding compost to the worms because the compost is already broken down, so the worms are gonna have an easier time to digest it. And you know, if I pick this stuff up here, you guys can see, look at that. I mean, it's pretty dusty, and there's like a lot of woody material. Now, they just don't take this stuff raw and you know, put it in their worm bin to feed them. They actually sift it out first. And so let's go ahead and show you guys next, actually the sifter, and to what mesh or particle size they screen to. So now I wanna share with you guys how they take those raw compost you guys saw that's like has a lot of woody material, and actually screen it down to make a nice bedding for the worms, right? They could add all that material into the worm beds, and the worms would probably be fine, but the fact of the matter is they're gonna take a lot longer to break that down. Plus, you know, all those chips and all those big particles are gonna take a lot longer to break down, and they won't be able to make as actually the quantity of worm castings in such a short time, because it's gonna take up space that they could actually be using, you know, the sifted out worm casting. So this is their rig here to sift it out. It's fully automated. And they got it, you know, basically a screen on there with all the raw compost here that goes in. It goes up in the screen and then sifts out. So let me go ahead and show you guys actually how they're specifically doing it. All right, so as you guys can see, the machine's on. They take shovelfuls and just dump it in there. And then basically the little conveyor belt brings it up into the machine, and then it tumbles it. So let me go ahead and show you guys the tumbling action. All right, so I don't know if you guys can see that, but if you look carefully down in this area, it's literally raining compost right here. And if we pick this stuff up here, unlike the stuff before, I mean, this is some really nice, rich, fine stuff. And this is the stuff that, you know, I like to screen out in my garden to use in my raised beds, because once again, I don't want to have big particulate particles in my raised beds, because that's taking up space that I could be having some really nutritious compost. And that's what they're feeding the worms here. So this is step one. It's like, I think, down to an eighth of an inch. Now I want to share with you guys actually all the stuff that actually came out that was the rejected stuff that they'll also use here on site. So once it goes through this sifter here, you guys can see it's just sifting out, and all this stuff is dumping on this side. And what we have here is basically all the big wood chips. And this stuff, you know, I mean, you could use it as a mulch or something like that, but they could sell it as a mulch, but then it's not quite as valuable to them. So they actually take this stuff and they actually recompost it down to get it break down further. You know, you guys saw the pile over there, 120 degrees. They're gonna add this to that pile, let it continue to break down further, and next time they run this to get the sifted material, some of this stuff may have broken down, some of it won't, and it just keeps cycling until it's fully broken down and then end up getting fed to the worms. So really what you're seeing here is really just worm food. So you guys just saw how they make the main bedding or the main food for the worms. and you know, the basically screened out compost. And I've seen other places around that I've visited, you know, feed the finished compost to the worms, which I definitely is a step in the right direction. You know, a really cool place, Veteran Compost, run by veterans in Maryland, actually. Visited them, and they're feeding their compost to the worms to make a value-added product, right? To turn their compost that sells for, you know, relatively inexpensive into worm castings that sells for a lot more. And while I think that's great, right? The worm casting, the quality of the worm casting is only as good as what the worms are feeding on, right? And in order to have good high quality worm castings, you do need to feed the worms based on my observations and research, you know, certain items. And so this is the part of the video that's probably the most important out of the whole video today, is the additional ingredients that you will want to feed your worms to have super spectacular results. I know you guys might have seen a lot of research online, like, hey, if you use worm castings, you know, it's going to prevent aphids in your garden, you're going to get better growth and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, granted, that may be true depending on the quality of the worm casting and what they're feeding the worms, right? Worm castings with high chitinase content and, you know, are going to be better at allowing your plants to defend themselves against the insects. You know, worm castings with higher cellulase content or cellulase degraders are going to be more effective at actually fertilizing your plants. So we want a balance of these, as well as a lot of different other things, beneficial components, which is mainly the biology in the worm casting. So in order to do that, you need to feed your worms, in addition to the main bedding and food source, other things. And that's what you guys are seeing behind me. They have literally pallets and little totes of all kinds of different ingredients that they feed their worms here. Now, I'll be the first to tell you guys that the owner here, Brian, he's a cool guy, but you know what? He's invested a lot of money into this whole setup here. And as much as I've tried to extract as much information out of him as possible for you guys, so that you guys could do it too. You could start your own worm company wherever else in the world, because I think worm casting should all be produced locally and used locally instead of being shipped all over the country, right? I'm not sure if he's telling me all the ingredients, and I'm not probably going to be able to extract from him, or when I interview him, I'm going to ask him, you know, what percentages of each one you're using. He's probably not going to share that, because it's like proprietary information. He's kind of secretive, not like Josh at the Boogie Brew Company, where he's like going to be open source and kind of tell you a rough estimate. I'll try to get out of him later, but but I am going to share with you guys the different ingredients he uses here, as well as some of my recommendations for other ingredients that you may want to use as well to have a high quality worm casting. So now I want to share with you guys the special ingredients they actually use to add to their bedding mix that you guys see behind me here, or that sifted compost you guys just learned about. And we have bins of these things. And once again, I don't know the quantities they add, so we're gonna maybe talk to Brian and see if we can get those out of them a little bit later. But these are the ingredients, and these ingredients that I'm gonna share with you guys, you know, in most cases, actually, these are ingredients that actually I would add into my gardening raised beds, which are just good to feed the biology. And then literally that's what they're doing here. All these ingredients are added to the worm castings to feed not only the worms, but more importantly, the biology, to create massive growth and massive biology. Because really the truth about the worm castings are, the power in the worm castings are not because they're worm castings. The power in the worm castings is because all the biology that comes along with the worm castings. And so they've determined by testing, and they've been in business now 6 years through trials and tribulations of using, you know, a handful of this, a bucket full of that, and this and that, and they come up with their own specific recipe, you know, to encourage that they have the highest levels of biology. And, you know, how does that work out in the end when you actually use their product? Well, as I learned last summer, it, you know, boosted my production by like 2 times. And so that's how important the biology is, whether you're doing that with worm castings or by, you know, adding some of these ingredients to just the compost you're making in the first place. So let's go ahead and go over some of these guys. Over on this side, of course, we have the biochar. Biochar is super critical, super important. You know, it does add a carbon aspect to whatever you're putting it into. But the other thing about the biochar to me is that it actually adds a lot of surface area and a place for the microbes to have a home. Next, they got the coffee grounds here. And if you guys look closely at these coffee grounds, man, they look kind of like moldy or something. And I don't know if that's a mold or if that's actually a fungus. But, you know, these are spent coffee grounds that they get from local coffee shops. And they source all their materials very carefully to ensure they're going to get the highest quality materials. And I would encourage you guys to do that as well. Instead of going to, say, a Starbucks for your materials, right, try to find a local homeschool, you know, coffee roaster that roasts their own coffee, that does it all organic, right? and get those ones instead of the potentially contaminated, you know, or roasted at too hot of a temperature Starbucks, right? So yeah, they got the coffee grounds here. Up next, another one I just like to add to my garden. I think the coffee grounds are the only thing that I don't like to add to my garden directly. Any of these other materials actually will go into my raised bed, or even better than that, into the raised bed, is into my compost pile to compost along with my food scraps and yard waste, right? To make a really rich compost in the first place. Next, they have one of my favorite things. It's the kelp here. So the kelp adds a variety of nutrients and plant-based nutrients, as well as the trace minerals and seaweed hormones and whatnot to the mixture to feed not only the worms, but also the bacterial and fungal content. Next, of course, my favorite thing here, actually, this is the rock dust. So they're using a nice black, rich rock dust here, not super powdery. Has some fine particulate in there. And that might be good for, you know, for the worms' gizzards, if they had gizzards, to kind of like clean them out. So it's good to not have everything to a fine, consistent dust powder, the smallest particle size, right? You want to vary your particle sizes. On some ingredients, you might want it super fine. On other ingredients, you might want to have it a mixture. Like this rock dust, there's plenty of fine powder, but there's also larger particle sizes. Now the rock dust, you know, that's my number one gardening secret for you guys, and probably a big secret of the worm castings they create here and why they're so beneficial, right? What does the rock dust do? Does the rock dust make your plants, like, you know, have much higher nutrition and all this kind of stuff? Well, yes, indirectly, but more importantly, what the rock dust does, it actually feeds the bacteria, feeds the microbes, so that they could have like a smorgasbord of all the different trace minerals they need. And standard conventional farming, and even organic farming to a big extent, actually does not focus on any more minerals than 3 or maybe 16, right? The rock dust that I'm showing you guys right here has up to 70 different trace minerals contained within it that really keep the microbes happy and allow them to do their job the best, and to even more importantly, reproduce more efficiently. So that's why I encourage you guys to not only add it to your worm castings, also add it to the compost you're making, and of course also add it into your raised beds. I have plenty of other videos specifically on rock dust. I actually have a really good videos with a rock dust expert that I visited out on the East Coast. Next ingredient, also a very important one, these are the humates. So this is a black soil humates. This stuff will actually stain your hands black, so I'm not gonna pick it up and touch it for you. But once again, the soil humates, you know, another really good source of minerals and another food, right, for the worms. As you guys see, they just don't feed their worms the compost. They feed a variety of different ingredients, because every different ingredient is gonna affect the worms and also the biology of the worm castings. And of course, here's the last ingredient. This is the ingredient that most people leave out, and I think it's very important to feed worms this ingredient, and it's basically a high chitin rich ingredient. This could be something like, you know, ground up exoskeletons of insects, or in this case, they're using a crab shell meal. You could use shrimp meal. You could probably use, like, you know, clippings of your nails or hair and all this kind of stuff. But we want to really feed the worms a lot of chitin, because when you do that, you know, the worms are going to have to basically create enzymes in their systems to digest the food that they're eating. Much like us, right? If we're eating a diet of fruits and vegetables, right, our bodies are used to eating fruits and vegetables, and we have bacteria in our stomach that really thrive on the fiber and all this kind of stuff. If you're unfortunately eating lots of meat products and all this kind of stuff, right, your bacterial microbiome are not going to be super healthy and not going to be used to eating vegetables. So then if you start to try to eat healthier and eat more vegetables, you're going to get stomach aches, and your stomach's gonna be tripping out because your microbiome is not proper, right? So I think it's very important to, you know, once again, eat a variety of things yourself, especially focusing on the plant-based foods for us, but especially for the worms, right? We want to feed them a nice chitin rich materials, such as they're doing here. And once again, you know, I don't know the ratios of this, but if I had to guess, you know, I would probably the biggest thing I would put in my worm mixture, if I was making one, are these guys. Probably next, I'd probably put a ton of rock dust. Let's see, next, what I would put. I'd probably put, because they're free, literally, like the coffee grounds, but not too much. You could probably go overboard on that. Of course, biochar, generally recommended, you know, no more than maybe 10 to 20% biochar in, like, the soil you're mixing at home. And I'd probably do the same for the worms. I mean, these are just my estimates. I mean, I'd put as much kelp as I can afford. The kelp is an expensive product, but I think it can quietly improve the worm castings a lot. And of course, then we got left with the soil humates. You know, that'd be a much smaller percentage compared to all the other ingredients, in my opinion. So yeah, that's all the ingredients they add to their mixture. Next, I want to show you the cool mixing machine that they actually mix all this stuff in. All right, so now what you guys are seeing is actually they're mixing up the bedding material. You know, once again, that screened out compost plus all the different ingredients in their perfect proportions. They put it in this big mixer here. You know, I've seen places use concrete mixers and all this kind of stuff. You know, that's too small a scale. And concrete mixers are meant for mixing concrete. They're not meant for mixing, like, all these different, you know, soil amendments. Because I know, because I bought a concrete mixer to, like, mix soil stuff up. It doesn't work really well. What I need is one of these guys. This holds actually a 1 cubic yard. And this is actually a grain mixer meant for grain mixing grain. And it's spinning around there, mixing all this stuff. And then after it's done mixing, they'll actually then spin it out to a fluffer, which is also another very important component to the system. So let's go ahead and check out and see how that fluffer works. So after the bedding material has been mixed, then it goes through this fluffer here, and they're just, you know, they didn't turn this on because it gets kind of loud, but basically it fluffs up the material really nice and fluffy. And that's the stuff right down here. If we look at it, this is a nice mixture with all the different ingredients mixed in. You can't even see the rock dust, you can't see the humates, you can't see the kelp, you can't even see the crab shells, but it's all mixed in here in a nice fine mixture. Now, I believe it's very important to fluff up the mixture so you don't have big, you know, clods that are all, like, you know, solid. Worms can't really burrow through there too effectively. Also, when they fluff this up, it makes it for a nice bedding material so that the worm could go to work. And also, there's more BSA or bacterial surface area for the bacteria to grow, you know, when it's fluffy instead of when it's, like, packed down. So they take this nice fluffy material and they actually fill it up in one of these bins with the worms and then let them get to work. Once they have made their fluffy bedding material, they take some of that fluffy bedding material and put it down maybe about that much or that deep in one of these big totes. And the cool thing about these totes is that you know, these totes were formerly used for picking fruit, like oranges or whatnot. And these are basically the damaged reject totes that the big grower cannot use anymore because they're damaged. So then they buy these at a vastly discounted rate and reuse them. Because they are damaged and can't be used properly for the intended purpose. And then when they're actually, if these get damaged more, then they could actually return them, and the manufacturer of these guys actually will melt these down to make even further totes. So that's really cool that they're more sustainable in that respect. And if you guys are looking for one of these, you know, it'd probably be good to, you know, find big growers in your area that use these guys and see if they have any old ones. Maybe they'll be willing to sell them to you for cheap, or maybe even you'll pick one up for free. But, you know, I think these are a really cool way to grow the worms. But anyways, they fill up that bedding mixture, you know, maybe about this deep in the bottom. So most of this is actually, it's really low in here. And then they actually split some of the worms. So, you know, they want a certain worm density in each bin. They have found that if there's too many worms in a bin, then the worms are not as productive. And literally, there's too much worms for the amount of food in the bin. So when the quantity of worms get to be too much, then they split the worms and take them out of bins that have too much, and then they create new bins. And as I said a little bit earlier, they have approximately around 100 bins growing at this time, and they hope to get up to 300. But yeah, and then they basically just let it sit here. And once they let it sit here, it's pretty easy to keep your worms. You have to do only a few things. Number one is they have to feed them. So on a regular basis, depending on the time of year, they'll feed them. In the wintertime, they'll maybe feed once a week, because when it's colder out, worms don't move as fast. Neither does the microbiology, bacteria and microbes. They don't like to work as quickly either. And then maybe in the hotter time of the year, springtime, they might feed, you know, 3 times a week. And maybe even in the summer, they might even feed, you know, more often than that. And the other thing that they need to do is also maintain the proper moisture level. This is also fairly very important, besides feeding the right you know, amount of food, maintaining the right moisture level. So that means generally maybe they might you know, water these guys on the top just a little bit if it's drying out too much, but generally the compost that they're adding is at a pretty good moisture level already. And so yeah, monitoring that's very important. I've seen so many personal worm bins fail just due to a too high of a moisture content. If you could pick up the soil and you could wring it out, that's too much moisture, right? These bins here, I mean, I'm not going to pick up and wring it out for you guys because I don't want to, like, damage any worms. Maybe I'll do that. There's not too many in here. But I could squeeze this, and I mean, it balls together and kind of crumbles apart, and that's actually a really good moisture level to have. If it's wetter than that and you're squeezing out water between your fingers, that's not too good. And you don't want it to be too dry where it just, like, crumbles like sand or something like that, right? So having the proper moisture level, super critical, super important. I mean, after that, all they got to do pretty much is just let the worms break down all the compost, all the different nutrients that they added to the compost, and then they just need to harvest it. All right, so next I want to go ahead and give you guys an overview shot of the worm farm here. And this is how it's laid out, basically. You guys only saw tight shots. But basically, we're in a beautiful Camarillo up in the hills. There's like all kinds of nopal cactus, you know, growing that'll make the fruits, and just the wide open space behind us, really beautiful, clean environment where they're making these worm castings. You know, I've seen worm castings being produced in downtown Chicago, you know, in bins like this. You know, they could be produced pretty much anywhere, but how they're doing it here, you know, is basically underneath hoop houses. So they got basically a double insulated hoop house with the plastic that actually does not let that much light through. So it lets the least amount of light transmission through, but while still remaining clear. And they got like two layers on there. And then they just have their bins all the way underneath. And so, you know, and then the other thing is that they're open on both sides, and they're open on the sides as well. This is super critical, right? I don't want you guys to fry your worms. Oh, they had it. John said they had it in a greenhouse. I'm putting mine in a greenhouse. No, don't put your worms in the greenhouse, man. They're gonna fry. Check it out. Here's the thing, basically, right? If we're comfortable, the worms are comfortable. If we're too cold, the worms are too cold, right? So like a perfect place to do it might be inside your house, in your bedroom that you keep at a nice comfortable temperature. Although that being said, your wife might not like that. But, or inside your house, or if you have a, you know, garage that stays cool in the summertime, very important, because the wintertime is gonna be a little bit colder, but the summertime, some garages could heat up really, really hot and the worms won't like that. But, you know, they like the temperatures we like, so that's what they're trying to emulate here. And because we're in Camarillo, has a nice mild climate, they're able to do it like this. If you live in other places, you're gonna have to do it a little bit differently, of course, especially, you know, in the wintertime to keep them warmer. And the summertime to keep them cooler. Yeah, that's very critical. But yeah, you can see all the little bins they have lining up all the way down. Next, I want to show you guys more about the harvesting and when they harvest these bins off to turn it into their casting product. So now I want to show you guys actually a bin that's on its way to ready to be harvested. I don't know if this is going to be harvested today, tomorrow, or even next week. But basically, the fact of the matter is this bin now, they've been adding their feed mixture, which is the same as their bedding mixture that you guys saw with all those ingredients, right? They just sprinkle it on top. They manually feed as needed, right? And what happens is, you know, all the stuff on the top is all like the fine particulate that the worms are not digesting. This also acts as like a mulch layer in our gardens to basically keep all the soil and the feed mixture down below nice and moist. But if I just skim some of this back, whoa, down below, like, I mean, I swear, like probably like a half inch underneath, I'm already hitting some worms here. I kind of feel bad for them that I just disturbed their slumber or their eating schedule. And then it gets kind of moist. So basically what the worms are doing is they're actually eating all the different materials that are added in, and then they're pooping out. And it's their worm poop or the worm castings is what we're after, because those are the really rich biological and fungal activity, you know, that they're offering for you guys in a package. I guess the other thing I want to say is that, you know, in this bin, since, you know, now it's probably filled up about 1.5 feet tall from the base of this, there's different size worms. You know, the larger worms, which are like the king worms, they've been around for a long time. They got like the best stuff, right? That's down lower is the good stuff that they like to eat, right? The smaller worms tend to kind of migrate up to the top, because the big worms, like, get out of here. I'm eating this good stuff. You guys got to go to the top stuff that's maybe not as choice to eat. So there's basically all kinds of worms living in here. And their goal is to have about 1 pound of worms per 1 square foot of density here. So these boxes are maybe approximately 4 feet by 4 feet. So they want to have about 15 pounds of worms in each one. If the density gets too much, then that's when they actually take some out, separate them out, and then they make basically start a new bin like I showed you guys just a little bit earlier. And once this gets up filled up nearly to the top, then they're ready to harvest their bin, and that's really where their money is in the worm castings. So I can't really show you that whole process, but they basically take this out with a loader, and then they actually run it through their little sifter down that you guys saw earlier. When they sift it out through their sifter again, you know, they're sifting out the worm bedding. They'll basically, all the castings fall into the bins down below, so it's screened to 1/8 inch, and then all the worms actually, and all the big materials actually fall out of the out of the screen into the bins in the back, and those big chunks and the worms are actually then put into a new bin to start this process all over again. So yeah, not too difficult to harvest worms if you got one of those nice mixers. If you guys need to do it at home, you know, some of the techniques you might want to do is if you shine really bright lights on the top, that'll force the worms, you know, to go lower. Another thing you could do is actually if you start only feeding on one side of your bin, the worms will migrate from the side where you're not feeding to the side where there is food, and then you could harvest the side of the bin that, you know, does not have the food that the worms have moved away from. You know, of course, you could also take your bin out and then try to, like, you know, get some kind of screen and screen them out. But be very careful, please, with your worms when you're trying to screen them out, right? A lot of times when you're screening them out, you're using your hands to sift it, and that could push the worms through the grates, and then they're not going to survive, because if you cut a worm in half, it's not going to be two worms. Sorry to tell you guys that, guys. But anyways, yeah, many ways to sift out worms. But once they got all that sifted out, then they got to dry their worm castings to the appropriate temperature. This is very important. They don't want to be selling water weight, right? They want to be able to sell a nice, you know, consistent moisture quality, you know, casting that's going to be more viable. If it's too wet, once it's bagged up, then the biological activity is going to go down. If it's too dry, the biologic activity is going to go down as well. So they want to have it at just the right temperature. So let me go ahead and show you guys actually how they do that on the farm here. So now you guys are looking at, once they screen out the worm castings from their bedding material, all the screened out material goes in something like this. And yes, if you're thinking, John, that looks like a shipping container that basically has been cut down maybe to like 2 feet tall, and they basically put all the castings in there. So, you know, while you could use something like a big concrete pad or whatever, right? As I said earlier in this episode, this farm is built all modular, so it could actually be picked up and moved if need be. They're probably not going to move anytime soon. But basically the shipping container, it's basically movable, and also it keeps all the worm castings contained. They have it underneath their hoop house here so that even if it's raining, they could still dry their worm castings to the proper moisture level to ensure a high quality product. And yeah, I mean, the reason why I like this is, number one, they got the cheapest damaged shipping container they could find for the least amount of money. That would have normally been going to the landfill that you can't use for shipping anymore because it got holes or the floor's messed up or whatever. And, you know, they basically cut it down. So I always encourage you guys, like the farm likes to do here, they like to reuse, like reusing those plastic totes, reusing the shipping container once its useful life in the industry it was designed is no longer good. And so as farmers, we could use a lot of different, you know, basically things that are junk. Another man's, one man's junk is another man's treasure, so they say. And so for, you know, this shipping container has a new life now, drying worm castings, which in my opinion, probably more valuable than shipping, you know, all these plastic things from China over to the USA. But yeah, that's how they dry it. And, you know, I like that if they're drying it on a concrete pad or the metal, right, the metal will absorb the heat. The concrete does that a little bit more efficiently. And even at night, you know, this will let off some of the heat that's stored within it. Of course, the concrete is a lot better to do this method. And in the future, maybe they're even going to make this system even better by having, you know, more ways that they could dry more efficiently in the container here. So once it's dried to the proper level, let me go ahead and show you guys actually what a good dried worm casting should look like. So now I'm sitting amongst the castings here at the farm. And if we pick up this big, like, block of stuff here, right? This block of stuff, oh, it's got like little things in there happening. But if your worm castings, you know, are sticking together like this, that's not a right moisture level, right? It's actually too wet. And then you're gonna be paying, especially if the stuff is sold by the cubic foot, you're paying for water weight instead of worm casting weight. Something very critical, right? Once again, like on the top here, right? If we just scoop out a layer of the top, let's see if I could do that, right? Oh, maybe the stuff on the side here, right? If I scoop off some of this stuff on the side and your worm castings look like this, like dust, that's too dry. You don't want it that dry, right? You want it right in between. Let's see if I can pick off some of this stuff that's it's kind of like crumbly, but not. Let's see if I can find some good stuff for you guys to show. All right, this stuff's pretty decent. It's not too dry, not too wet. If I try to like ball it up, let's see if I try to ball it up, it's going to barely ball up, right? And that's what we want. It barely balls up. If you squeeze it and it falls apart, that's too dry If it like balls up really good, that's too wet. It wants to be somewhere where it almost kind of wants to ball up, but just falls apart. So that's a really nice moisture level for the worm castings, so that the biology in the worm castings can stay alive. I think it's sad that especially when you start to ship worm castings and they've been hanging out a while in bags and they're sitting in the store shelf, you know, the biology may not quite be as active as it once was, say when it was tested in a lab, when they're giving them the you know, prime moisture content with the most biology. So I always encourage you guys to have the freshest and highest quality worm castings that you guys could get for the most biology, which in turn will give you the best bang for the buck and also the best growth for your buck as well. So now I want to share with you guys the finished castings here. You know, this batch was done the other day where they basically just sifted out one of these big totes. They separated out the worms, and now they have the finished castings, and these are the ones that came off the 1/8-inch screen. And this is a really nice consistency here. I show this to you guys, right? It's like, it's nice and crumbly, but it'll kind of want to stick together a little bit, so that's a really good moisture level to have. And also, if you're looking at this casting, and I always want to encourage you guys to check out the castings you're buying and make sure it's mostly castings and not other particulate, right? In this casting, to me, this casting looks a lot of like lots of castings, and you know, there's some other particulate matter in there, but it's like a really small portion. A lot of castings may have a lot of bedding material mixed in, and because they're screening it to such a fine you know, size, you're getting mostly castings for your money here, so you're gonna get a high quality product. Once they have these big totes here, they move them into the bagging room, which is next door. We'll take you guys in there in a second, and they basically use three of these scoops, which turns out to be about the 1 cubic foot that they put in each bag. So we're gonna go ahead and take a scoop of this stuff, and we're gonna show you guys how they bag it up special. So now I'm here in their bagging shed, and we're gonna show you guys their bagging process. This is not really like rocket science, but there's a few things actually, and important pointers that I wanna share with you guys. Number one, they have their bags here, right? And this is the Organic Solution Premium Worm Castings. And you know, besides just being a bag, they got the nice label on there. And this is a CDFA registered organic. And the CDFA standards are much higher than the OMRI standards. So I always encourage you guys to look for CDFA organic, because that's even to a higher standard than just the standard OMRI or organic certification on many bag soil products. But the other thing that I want you guys to notice about this bag is that, you know, this bag has these little small hole punches in there. And you know, that's very important when you're buying worm castings. The worm castings are a living product, much like if you go buy sauerkraut at the health food store, right? And it hasn't been pasteurized, it's in the refrigerated section. Not all sauerkrauts in the refrigerated section are unpasteurized. There's some that are. But many you know, local varieties are now unpasteurized. And that's a living product, a living foods product that's still living. The microbes are in there breeding, multiplying, and I would encourage everybody to eat some sauerkrauts, whether you're gonna, or you know, fermented vegetables, whether you're gonna buy them and buy the live stuff, or make your own. It's really easy. Before I left on this trip, I basically fermented about, I don't know, 3/4 of a gallon of some of my Apollo Napa cabbage. But yeah, as this is a living product, they have the holes in there so that the living microbes can breathe, right? So they don't suffocate in an oxygen-deprived environment of a heat-sealed bag. So, you know, if you guys see like bags that are fully sealed, it's maybe not the best. I mean, microbes could live in a sealed bag, you know, for a period of time, but if it's been in there for too long, they're gonna run out of oxygen, and then basically the microbial counts and the you know, viable activity of that, you know, compost or worm casting is actually gonna go down. So I really like that they actually punch their bags and allow their bags to breathe. This also allows them to, you know, get some of the air out once they're done packing it. So you're actually buying castings instead of just simply airspace. All right, so they take this bag here and they basically cut out a board, and they have some 5-gallon bucket tops here. They put this guy down in the bottom and put it over the top here, just funnel it down. And then they have a nice like little, you know, thing for like HVAC, like heating and whatnot. They put that over the top, and then basically they just take these castings and they pour 3 you know, heaping buckets full. And then once they're done, that's one full bag. I just did one bucket full today, so this bag's a third full. They pull them out, and then they heat seal these guys up, and these guys are all ready to go out to local stores or distributors. So these are the bags for local distribution. Unfortunately, the Organic Garden Solution casting is only maybe available in the Southern California area. You know, not too many places sell this casting, so you probably won't be able to find it at your local shop unless you're here in the Ventura or Southern California area. That being said, they do make it available online on their website. Well, and you guys will learn a little bit more about that later. And they have actually a different bag they use when they do their shipping, so that it could be most economical when shipping in a flat rate box. So aside from producing this casting product, they produce actually a few other products that I want to share with you guys as well. They take their casting product, which is already really good, and then they basically use it to make a few other products that are really good and useful for your garden as well. That being said, the casting product is my favorite thing, because I don't want to buy diluted castings. And basically, when you buy their value-added products, you're buying something that's diluted. Not to say that they're not good, but I just want the castings because I could get some of the other things in their products from other places myself. So now I'm in their storage shed, where actually once they bag up their product, they got them in sealed bags, they go in here for storage until they go out to the customers. And they have a few main products. Number one, of course, you guys saw me bag up their organic solution, premium worm castings, 100% organic amendment for your garden and indoor plants. Happy plants start with happy soil. So this is 100%, non-diluted castings. This is what I recommend for you guys, especially if you guys are getting castings shipped to you. Of course, they have some other value-added products that are also can be quite beneficial for your garden, such as the Super Char. This is a proprietary blend of biochar, earthworm castings, humic acid from Leonardite. And this is, mostly the biochar, not the castings. I think biochar is much more easy to make than actually the worm castings. It's easy just to burn and pyrolysize some wood, and it's really light to ship. So in my opinion, if you're shipping this stuff, don't waste your money on buying this stuff when you could get the worm castings that actually then reinfuse and activate your own biochar. Of course, last year they got the organic solution, number one brand, growers blend potting soil. So each batch of potting soil they individually test to make sure they have the right nutrition, so you guys are going to get excellent growing results. Once again, I wouldn't be buying a potting soil and having it shipped around, but if you guys live local, yeah, definitely you want to buy a bunch of these for your gardens so then you don't have to ship them. Right, but otherwise I'd make my own potting soil with locally sourced ingredients, but also adding their worm castings. And the final product that I might show you guys today, actually how they make it, because they got some really special technology to do this. This is their organic solution, Ambrosia. So this is their liquid organic plant food, which is basically derived from the worm castings that you could buy in a bag. So this is kind of like the, concentrated version. And it's like, it's similar to like a worm casting tea or compost tea. If you can't, I encourage you guys to actually just buy the castings and make your own compost tea. But if you guys can't do that, then they have a solution here that you can just actually just take this and dilute it down and then spray this concentrates into your garden to get some of the similar benefits of the worm castings. Next, I want to show you guys actually how they make some of this bottled product here. So now I want to show you guys actually how they turn their worm castings into another value-added product. I think that's what business should be about, is like making value-added products to offer more value and also make it easier for the consumers to get the desired results they want. Some people may not want to deal with worm castings, so they could get their Ambrosia product. And basically what the Ambrosia product is they take the active worm castings that have a lot of different biology in there, but also all the fiber and the particulate and organic matter. They're basically with using only pure filtered well water, they're taking the well water plus the worm castings and basically leaching out the biology and making a shelf stable for about a year of product, so that you can add biology to your garden, whether that's going to be adding it to your compost teas or doing some kind of soil drench with it to get the active components and the reason why the worm castings are so good. Let's go ahead and see this machine. It's kind of got an auger in here and it's spinning it. And then it kind of goes into this other thing where it's actually just basically like making a tea and just putting the water through the mixture to extract all the rich biology. So now, I don't know if you guys can see that, but basically in here, basically it's not currently in full operational mode, but normally this is under pressure where it literally blasts all the microbiology off the castings into the water that goes down below that then gets balled up to sell you guys. And I think this is a very valuable method. I personally, if you're local and want to buy some of these, I think that's great. But I think shipping water with the biology that, has a shorter shelf life than just the worm castings may not be the best idea to do. I would rather buy the worm castings myself and then use that to get the biology off myself, which would be much more valuable. But I think this product could help a lot of people that don't want to deal with making compost teas and all this kind of stuff. to have a nice high quality shelf stable product that you will get results with. So now you guys saw how the different processes are made here. I want to share with you guys some more information about worm castings and also a cool thing they're doing here. Basically they took two of those little bins and they basically they sawed part of the wall off, so they have like two sides, and they're doing testing between like different soil mixes to see which one's gonna grow the best. I want to show you guys this specifically to show you guys how you could have like a little raised bed using some of these harvest cartons or these big plastic bins. Whether you want to cut it down the middle and make one large bed like they've done here, whether you want to have them, two of them side by side, it's an excellent, easy way to have a garden that may be inexpensive. I think they buy these guys, damaged in the condition they're in, for around $60. I don't know how much they may be near you. They do get a lot of squirrels and pests and whatnot, so they built basically with some inexpensive PVC, just a hoop over the top with a PVC pole, and then basically going to drape this in a fabric cloth or even chicken wire to keep out all the different pests. So I really like that they've been doing testing here, and every batch that comes out they do some testing on. But the other important thing is to know is that they've tested other brands of compost or worm castings, and they compare theirs to others, and they're like, how can we make ours better? And so as a consumer, how will you know if a casting that you're potentially thinking about buying is a good casting or not? Well, what you're going to want to ask the manufacturer for is the testing, is the data, and you want to see that data and have them prove to you that it's good, because anybody could say castings are good. Oh yeah, my castings are better than yours. There's a whole lot of talk on the internet, let me tell you guys, right? But I want people to put their money where their mouth is. I know these castings are good because I did testing in my garden and it yielded more than the other casting that I used. And before you buy it, how are you going to know if it's good? Well, you're going to want to ask them for testing. So we have testing here that they do here at Organic Solution to ensure that their castings are good. And so you're going to want to ask for, number one, minimally want this test. This is called the Biological Analysis Soil Amendment, and this is an earth fort test. Basically, this is a food soil web testing of the biology in the worm castings, and that's the thing that's most important to me, not the NPK numbers or the nutrients in there. I specifically use worm castings for the biology, and so this is a biology report. Unfortunately, most places that produce compost or even worm castings don't have this report. So in my opinion, it's kind of like, you think you're healthy, you think you're eating healthy until you get a blood test, and then you see your blood test is way off, and you got to take a whole bunch of different vitamins and change your diet so that you could be healthy. But meanwhile, you're all big and you're all muscular and you think you're healthy, but then you drive a heart attack tomorrow, right? Just because something looks good doesn't mean it is going to be good. So that's why I like, confirmational testing. So I get my blood test done regularly to make sure I'm healthy. And if I'm not, hey, I could adjust and do better. And just like here, if their tests are not good enough, right, they're going to change their process, add things to their formula, do things a little bit differently to see if they could bump it up. And likewise, I encourage you guys to get your soil tested in your backyard. Hopefully I have an upcoming episode with that myself to show you guys my testing. But anyways, even if you don't know how to read this test, you're like, John, I asked for the test, but I don't know what it means. It's really easy to read this test, even for a layman that doesn't know all these different things and what they are. Basically, the reason why this test is easy to read is because they tell you what the result was, and that's in red, results, and it tells you the results. It tells you the comments, if it's good, above average, in range, or below, or poor, and then it tells you the expected range that you should be seeing. So if all else being equal, you want the expected range, you want the result to be in the expected range. So for example, the dry weight of these worm castings are 0.470, and that's a good range, and the expected range is between 0.2 and 0.8, right? You don't want them too wet, you don't want them too dry either, so they're right, actually pretty close to being in the middle. Active bacteria is 90.1, and that's above range. The expected range is between 3 and 30, so that's actually really good. So in general, depending on the test, being above range may be better, but not always. Total bacteria is a 1,780, that's in range. The expected range is 300 to 3,000. And then even more important than the bacteria to me are the fungi, and of course the fungirls, that was a joke, are important to have in the soil to have a good time or to get your plants that are growing optimally. So the active fungi in these were 33, and the expected range is between 3 and 30. So this is above expected range in a fungi, and most worm castings that I've seen, are usually not that high. So they're doing something special here, to get a high fungal count, which is very important and critical to optimal gardening success. And then a total fungi here is 1,077, and that's in range. The expected range is between 300 and 3,000. So for example, if I had like, you know, I picked this up and it was like 301. All right, it's in range, but it's in range low. This is in range, you know, maybe like a little bit less than half. Then of course they get into more specific things, but I think the main thing is the organism biomass is the most important to me. Then they go into specific protozoas and the numbers, and all these are actually either good, high, or good, which are in the range. And then there's organism biomass ratios and all this kind of stuff. But I think the main thing that you guys should be concerned about if you're not into soil science is just this top line here. And you know, according to this test, which was actually done 4/29/2016, you know, all this stuff looks really good to me. And then the other extra credit test that, you know, a company, if they're really touting the benefits of their worm castings for reduction of pathogens and actually higher growth levels, while it's good to have the biology, you know, this is the extra credit, the special sauce. And unfortunately, most companies that make the worm castings don't release their data to the public. I'm glad to say that Organic Solution is, and this is actually a microbial matrix test, and it's actually called the functional group analysis. You know, this is kind of just what's in there. It doesn't tell you actually if it's going to function and be really good. This is actually more functional and super important. So this will talk about the nitrifying bacteria. These are the bacteria that are actually going to make the fertilizer for your plants. So it's very important to have a high number. This one's 7.00E plus 09. And let me tell you, I was not a math major, so I don't even know how big of a number that is. I think on this test, personally, they should put the number with all the zeros, so it'd be more, look more impressive, and all those non-scientific types could understand it more clearly. I guess anyways, with its plus 09, that means another like 9 zeros or something. And then the phosphorus stabilizers, 2.80E plus 09. And then this is also very important, the salase degraders, right? This is really the engine of your soil. The salase degraders break down the organic matter in your soil, turn into nutrients for your plants. So if you have low salase degrader activity, right, your organic soil is not working for you. And that's why, you know, synthetic fertilizers work so well. Synthetic fertilizers don't rely on cellulase degraders to create fertility. So this one's a 1.00E plus 06. And then, of course, you know, the last one on here is the chitin utilizers. So chitin utilizers, once again, this is critical. If you want your worm casting to have, you know, basically anti-insect benefits, you want high chitin utilizers in there. And this one is actually 3.00E plus 05. So yeah, I explained those guys. I don't know what these numbers are because I would need to see, like, if I had this one versus one from another worm casting company to compare them, then you could clearly see like which one had higher viability on this specific sample, which was 5051-16. And I don't see the date on here. But nonetheless, you want to ensure that also the company you're buying the worm castings from has regular testing. And if they don't have regular testing, ask for their last testing, but ask for their last three testings, because then you could see trends. You know, a lot of places, they'll dial in their processes, and they don't change, and they do the same exact thing, and they get very similar results every single time. So if they don't have the current test, get their past three, and then you could kind of see the trends to see if, you know, hey, their new test based on their three old tests, it's probably going to be pretty similar, all right? So yeah, that's how you tell if something's really good or not. I think the final part of this episode, then I got to get out of here today because I got to film another episode later in the afternoon. I want to go ahead and interview Brian, the owner of the company that makes all this happen, that makes these high-quality castings for you guys. So now I have the pleasure of introducing to you guys and interviewing Brian Spangle, the worm wrangler and the owner here at Organic Solution. First off, Brian, I want to thank you for actually having me out and inviting me to your worm farm here and sharing this with my viewers, you know, to benefit you know, all my viewers in the world.
Well, we've been getting a lot of calls, and we were really excited on the pepper video. And you know, when it got to 1,000 hits, you promised to come down here, and we hit the 1,000 hits. So we're really glad you could make it. Rains are over. It's beautiful out here now. So it's really good timing. I'm glad you came.
Cool. Yeah, I'm glad to be here. You know, this is the third time that I attempted to come. You know, I was like, oh, I'll be in your area. I could stop by, and every time, you know, it just wouldn't work out. Our schedules conflicted. But, you know, things were meant to happen for a reason. I'm glad I came on such a nice day that I did today. So the first question I have for you, Brian, is why did you decide to start a worm casting company? It's a lot of work playing with the worms all day. And I mean, you're not going to like really get rich off this anytime soon. So why?
Well, I'm a recovering landscape architect, and when the big recession hit, just through a series of coincidences, I clicked in with an old buddy of mine, and he was giving up on general contracting and moving into this, and that's how this thing all started. It's kind of a logical outgrowth of what I used to do. In a way, I'm still dealing with plants, I'm still dealing with soil, but on a totally different level. And I really like the worms. It's fun working with worms. They don't look that entertaining, but actually they're very fascinating creatures. And they do some just amazing things. And as scientists keep working on finding out how soil biology is really working and what the worms are actually doing, it's going to turn out to be quite phenomenal, because the worms are amazing creatures. I mean, no discernible brain, no eyes, multiple hearts, and yet I can put a ripe strawberry in the middle of one of those bins, and in about 2 hours, they're all right there eating that strawberry. So how do they do that? How do they know that there's something good in there to eat in the bin with no discernible sensory organs like we have? But they're just phenomenal, and what they do with what they eat is stunning.
Yeah, so I know you've experimented with different kinds of worms here. So what kind of worms are you using now? What kind of worms did you try to grow before?
Initially we started with African nightcrawlers, which are a really big worm, and they have a very specialized diet that they need, and they also need to be, because they're from Africa, they need to be warm. They need to be at 80 degrees. And they get to be about the size of a number 3 pencil.
Wow.
I mean, they're really big worms, and they eat a phenomenal amount. But we were in not a good environment. We started in a greenhouse, and we just couldn't get combination of humidity and warmth together for them, and we were meanwhile running the flow through at that time, which John showed a little footage of, and in that we had the red wigglers, which are pretty much what most people use for doing earthworm production. And as the African nightcrawlers perished, we just shifted more and more over towards the red wigglers, and that's where we are now. We're like 100% red wigglers, and they're extremely fat and happy in this new place. We've been here about a year now, and they're just loving it. They're just reproducing like crazy and eating like crazy, so it's all good out here.
Awesome. So I want to talk more and encourage you guys out there, to get the worms that are, native to your geographical zone. So if you're in Africa, right, and you're 80 degrees year round, you might want to get those night crawlers, right? And if you're here in the States, more than likely you're going to want to get the standard red wigglers. Super important. So Brian, why are the worm castings so valuable to gardeners and to landscape architects and just even farmers? Why should they be using the worm castings?
Okay, well, this all goes into the soil food web and how the soil processes nutrients so that plants can take them up. And the worms are a really huge component of that whole equation. And they manage to consume organic matter, and as it's passing through their body, they're inoculating that with just hundreds of thousands of different kinds of bacteria. And they're also adding other things, chitinase, they're adding some growth hormones, some growth regulators, I mean, a whole bunch of stuff. It's amazing what these things do. And when that comes out the other end of that worm, that's soluble, which means it dissolves in water and roots can take that up. So they're processing a big storehouse of material that should be in your soil. If you got organic matter in your soil, that's what they're working on. And so if you're working with the soil food web, then you're feeding the soil so the soil can feed the plants, versus the way most of us have been raised in you know, you apply 20 pounds of nitrogen to an acre and you get, you know, 15 bushels of corn. The soil food web turns that the other way around. Build up that soil, you don't have to put in nearly as much fertilizer of any kind. And that big process, and it involves an awful lot of different components, but worm castings are a huge way. I mean, what we're doing is we've taken what the worms are doing naturally, and then just through their diet, we're boosting the bacteria and the variety of stuff that they're putting out into the casting. So we just amped up basically their chemistry by feeding them things that reinforce that and make it easier for them to generate more. For instance, we feed them chitin. They automatically exude a certain amount of chitin A's in their castings, but we boost that by putting a lot more into their bedding material. And the chitin A's bacteria then also feed off of the chitin that we put into the soil. So, you know, that it's just reinforcing basically what the worms are already doing. It took a bunch of years to figure out what the diet was, but you know, our lab reports are coming back really with really good results, and we've even finally gotten fungal. So you know, we feel like we kind of fine-tuned this. They're a really high grade worm casting.
Yeah, I mean, just using it in my garden shows me that. And also the reports show that as well, Brian. But I guess the other thing I want to ask you is, you know, you talked about adding some of the different things into your bedding mix, and you guys saw the things that they use here. Would you care to share the different proportions so my viewers could duplicate this at home? And if you don't want to share the exact proportions, I completely understand. So give me a nice large range.
No, I don't want to share what the proportions are. If you're going to do this at home, then, you know, what you're looking at are really small quantities of material. But, you know, we spent 6 years getting to this point, and we just don't really want to give it all away. We don't mind giving you what it is that we're using, but we don't want to tell you exactly how we're mixing it all together. But you can do this at home on just getting, you know, small quantities of these things. We're having to buy this stuff in, you know, big bulk sizes. But you can be adding all of these things to a worm bin if you've got a worm bin, or if you're lucky enough to have enough room to compost, you know, if you go through your compost pile, I would be stunned if you didn't have worms in there, as long as you kept it moist. So, I mean, I've yet to go to a compost pile that didn't have worms in it.
And that's like a standard pile on the ground, not necessarily like a compost tumbler where there generally wouldn't be worms.
Right. No. Yeah. So we're talking about just the, you know, not a, at my house, it's static. We don't have time to really turn that thing. But any kind of pile that's being turned and having moisture added to it, you're going to wind up with worms. I mean, we met a man from Michigan who, you know, was doing this all through the winter. I mean, he mounded up his windrows really high. Like, he put about 4 feet of extra material over those windrows to insulate the worms from the cold. But he said, you know, all winter long, if you dug into that pile, they were still working. They were just working where it was still warm, not where it was freezing cold.
Right. So, yeah, you guys could potentially keep worms wherever you are in the country all year round, provided you do it properly. So, Brian, another thing I want to talk to you about, I know you experiment with a lot of different feedstocks and things to add to make your worm castings. What are, besides the things that you use here, what would be some other ingredients that people might want to try at home, you know, to bring up the quality of their casting? Because I recommend a diversified diet for us, but also a diversified diet for the worms that I think can only benefit.
Well, the used coffee grounds, I mean, most people drink coffee or at least have access to a coffee shop. The used grounds are, they love coffee grounds. And it's an excellent slow-release nitrogen for your soil. So if you're using that, that's a terrific way to go. Initially we worried that coffee grounds would be too acid, but actually when you brew coffee, you're drinking the acid, and the grounds wind up being around a 7. They're neutral. So that's a really great thing to feed them. You know, if you are prepping a lot of vegetables at home, don't just throw that stuff away. You can, Vitamix that, or just chop it up a little bit better and toss it into a worm bin. They love that. They don't like citrus too much. They don't like a lot of the herbs. But what we found is you can feed them actually any of those things as long as they have somewhere else to go. But if you like covered your entire bed with your worms in it with, say, orange peels and cilantro, you'd probably run into a problem. But if you took and put just a small amount of it off to the side somewhere, all of that cooks down to a point, they'll eat it. It's just the initial, I think, that there are a lot of acids and in the citrus, and then the herbs have, the herbs are herbs for a reason. They're there to keep bugs away from themselves. So the oils are, but all that stuff breaks down. It's just you don't feed them nothing but that. You can put in a small amount of that. Newspaper, they like newspaper. They don't seem to like paper. We were shredding paper for a while. They don't really like paper as much as newsprint, which seems to be more broken. It's just
softer.
It's a much easier material for them to break down or deal with. And they really love cardboard. We don't deal with the cardboard here, but we know a lot of people that grind up cardboard and work that into their bedding material. And we think what they really like is the glue, but we're not sure. Obviously, corrugated cardboard, they like that because if it's wet in there, they can just slither in through all of those corrugations. But basically, as long as you don't feed them, they're protein averse, so you don't want to feed them any meats. And you need to be careful on, there are some commercial mixes out there, and some of them are a little heavy on protein. The African nightcrawlers were much more sensitive to that than these red wigglers are very forgiving. I mean, really, I don't know what you got to do to kill them. I know about 50 different ways to kill an African nightcrawler, but the red wigglers are really a great way to go. And you can get these, buy them by the pound. And if you're thinking about how to do this, if you're, say, going into a compost pile, you want to figure about a pound per square surface foot. And that's a really good way to go. I mean, that's you're probably running into a bunch of money that you might not want to be doing, but that's kind of the ratio that we use when we're, say, starting the flow-through bin. It's a pound of worms per square foot.
All right, good deal. So what's one tip that you'd like to share with my viewers or for people that are trying to like grow their own worms at home, like the one tip that you see a lot of places or people trying to have worms and they fail? So the one thing that, so they, people can be successful at raising worms.
Well, the one thing I see is the sort of modular worm, round worm bins. Those are really very slow to produce castings like we're getting. But what they are good at producing after a couple of months is, what do we call that?
Leachate,
exactly. Which is a term that it sounds a little disparaging and is, considered in the industry not to be a good product. But I know down in Mexico, they're raising worms in half-cut 55-gallon barrels all in an array with a gutter running underneath, and they are just after the leachate. They don't care about the castings, and they, every 3 days they run water through that, and then they just pump that straight out into the irrigation system and out into the field. So if you want to be getting something, the leachate is a pretty good thing to do, and you can just be running water through your bin and collecting it at the bottom. Because you don't know exactly what's in the leachate and the condition of, there's can be a lot of bad stuff going on potentially in a bin, I wouldn't necessarily use that on any vegetables that I was going to eat. I mean, if you were going to pour it onto the soil, that'd probably be okay, but I wouldn't I wouldn't be pouring it onto tomatoes or peppers or, you know, any, you wouldn't put it onto the fruit. I used to use this, I had a small black bin, and I just used it on the roses, and the roses loved it. And so that's really the biggest bang you're gonna get, I think, out of those bins. You're gonna be waiting a very long time to produce, you know, even an eighth of what you get in one of our bags. So, but it's a nice way to get rid of, if you, say you live in an apartment, you can be doing one of these bins indoors. You know, they don't smell if you're doing it right, and they don't make a mess if you're, you know, catching your leachate, and then you could just use it on houseplants.
Cool. So let's talk about the difference between leachate and, you know, your water-based ambrosia extraction. Like, what's the differences between those two? Why would somebody want one versus the other?
Well, the leachate is just sort of working its way through in one of those worm bins. It's working its way through everything that's in that bin, and you don't really have much control over what is going on in, say, the bottom of that bin, unless you're cleaning it. The extract, all those machines, every bit of that machine, the tank, the hoses, the extractor, the heads, every moving part, all of that stuff gets totally disinfected. We use Sanidate, which is kind of a scary hydrogen peroxide industrial strength sanitizer. You know, get a spot on it, on your skin, and it turns white and just disappears. But so everything that we do is sanitary, and it's all stainless steel. So what we're doing is we're running those castings through the head, and the head is with the high pressure jets. We didn't turn those on because that machine is really loud, and you wouldn't have heard anything that John had to say. We just ran, just had the stuff augering through. But when you turn that thing on, it's high pressure water washing the biology and a lot of the nutrients off of the castings. And we don't use anything in our bedding that can potentially give us E. coli or fecal coliform. Mm. So, we've got a clean environment in the bins, and the worms themselves tend to make things very sanitary. I mean, they wipe out E. coli, they just literally absorb it in their bodies somehow. So you're running through a sanitary system. You've got a known element, because we're CDFA certified for organic, so we have to get all this stuff tested every year. So we know that what we're generating is clean, and then it's running through a clean machine, so there's really nothing that can go wrong. The beauty of the ambrosia is it doesn't have the huge numbers of biology, and not necessarily even the diversity of biology that you get out of compost tea, but it's stable and it's sitting there on the shelf. You don't have to spend, you don't need any forethought to prep, get your compost tea going, and then be ready the second that tea hits its sweet spot. You know, you don't have to coordinate with getting it out onto the plants. This is just going to be sitting on your shelf, and you dilute it out and pour it on, and you're done.
Cool. So let's talk about, why would somebody want to buy the ambrosia versus like just your compost tea and brew their own ambrosia or make their own ambrosia?
Well, if you want to buy a $30,000 ironic extractor, then you too can make an ambrosia. But there are other ways to make extracts from, you can do extract without using the ironic extractor. There, if you go online, you can see that's a really old technique that's been around forever. I mean, they used to make manure extracts. They used to make all kinds of different extracts. Long before one of these machines came along. So that is something you can do at home. This is just a different segment of the market. A lot of people that are hydroponically oriented, you know, 4 ounces of this to a gallon of solution, you know, you're done. Mm. So,
all right, cool.
You can make your own extract if you like.
Yeah. just not gonna be made with a $30,000 machine that might do it better. Yeah, I mean, just simply taking like a brew bag and just dunking the put the castings in the brew bag and just dunk it in water and just let it sit there overnight. I mean, that would make some kind of extract.
Yeah, and if you bubbled it.
Yeah, bubbled it.
Then
yeah,
you'd
of
be beating it up a little more, get a little more of that stuff out of there, and you'd be adding oxygen, so you'd probably be stimulating a little bit of you know, bacterial growth.
Yeah, I
so
mean,
it's not a hard thing to do.
Yeah.
I know the those manure extracts, I heard people let them sit for like a week or 2 weeks.
Yeah.
But that's, I'm a little hazy on that. So.
Yeah. I wouldn't do manure extracts myself. And talk about manure, you know, one of the first places I learned about worm castings actually was down in San Diego, and I don't know if they're still in business now, but basically they had a cow farm. And basically, they turned their cow manure into worm castings and then sold them. So you want to explain maybe why that maybe is not the best idea to make, you know, castings out of only single stock manure?
Well, actually, that's not a bad system. And the trick is to have enough room to, you need to really control the manure is not going to go straight to the worms. It's going to go to an intermediate step, which would be composting. And in that process, you got to heat that up to at least about 140 degrees, and you're going to wipe out the E. coli and the fecal coliform. So that's, you know, there's a big outfit back east that does this. They're sitting right on a dairy farm, and that's a great way to go. We tried at one point using composted cow manure, and we had problems. We had fecal coliform and we had E. coli. And so that was a big problem to get rid of. And the first step in getting rid of it was changing the feedstock and eliminating that. But that was really the composting end of that that was the problem. And we had no control over that. So, you know, and even then we were getting that for free. And as Mary Kellogg told me once at Kellogg Soils, her uncle once gave her advice. Sometimes free is just too expensive. And fecal coliform and E. coli cost us about 3 months of production, and it was a nightmare getting rid of it, sterilizing everything, the bins, the screens, the machines, I mean, anything that touched the castings, and to cycle through and get rid of that manure and base casting and get back onto what we do now. So we have no manures and we have no problems. It would be a great way to go if you had the ability to control the composting and do that. And we don't really have the room or the inclination to do that. And it also gets into a whole thing with the county and, you know, it's just not, this is just so much cleaner.
Yeah, right. I mean, the other thing that's important to me anyways is like, you know, toxins that may come along with the manure. So like if the animals are being fed a genetically modified feedstock or antibiotics or other kind of drugs that might be in the manure, which then might end up in the worm castings. And of course, aside from all that is, let's talk about the quality of the worm castings, or like if a manure-based worm casting did the biological test that my viewers saw just a little bit earlier, how would they turn out? How would the fungal numbers be, for example? You know, how would the chitinase degrader numbers be on a pure manure-based casting?
That I don't know, because we were using the components that you saw earlier.
With manure.
Yeah, so we didn't really see any particular spike in any of that. And what we don't test for is NP and K. We got an initial test when we were doing our first CDFA certification and California Department of Food and Agriculture. And our numbers were so low, they were, you know, 1.01 and 0.00 something. So, you know, we're not claiming any kind of NP or K on our products. I suspect that maybe in a manure-based product, you might get a little bit more in the N range than you'd get from us. But one of the beauties of our product is this, you know, if you're, say you're growing hydro, You're keeping extremely close track of the nutrients that you're putting in. Our nutrients aren't going to screw up your numbers because we're negligible. And so, I personally don't have anything against the steer-based manures. It didn't work for us, but that wasn't really because of the manure. It was because of that composting step. And just by their design, the red wigglers are actually manure eaters. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, if you go out to a cow farm or out to a stable, anywhere outdoors where you can see nice patties from the cows or horse droppings that have been down for a couple of days, you look underneath there, you're going to find red wigglers. Oh, I
see. So the main reason I probably don't like the manure, pure manure-based castings is because they're not adding all the other ingredients to create all those high bacterial and fungi numbers that you guys, you know, saw earlier when I showed you guys some of the test reports here. I don't know if I have any other questions for you today, but I do want to say that, you know, your castings work really great for me, and I'm sure they'll work for you also, my viewers out there. But what do you recommend for actually, how much castings do you use when supplementing your garden, or what's the most efficient and effective way to utilize the castings if you can't get them in, you know, huge quantities?
Well, we recommend, we do it by the square foot. So we're recommending 1.5 cubic feet of castings when you're prepping your beds. So if it's springtime, I just spent the weekend doing this at my house, you'd be spreading out the castings at the rate, figure out what your square footage is, and then you can figure out how many bags you need, and then you just do that, spread that out evenly, and then turn it into the soil. But the other thing you can do with castings is you can just be top dressing with those, and they'll wash down all the goodies, the great stuff from the casting will wash right down into the root zone. So if you've already prepped your beds and you don't have, you know, the ability to do all of that, then you just top dress, and that's really, you know, maybe a quarter, half inch, just around where you think probably the root mass is underground, and then just water it in. And we recommend that once a month. You know, if you're really like a fanatic tomato guy or something, then you might be going every other week. But once a month is, I do it once a month, so.
All right, cool. Yeah, I mean, the other thing I like to do with the worm castings is, you know, when you're doing transplants and you're planting your transplants in your garden, you know, I like to use a scoop like per hole. That way it's right exactly in the root zone where the plant needs it to be. And of course, also top dressing in would be a good thing to do. And of course, you know, another way that you could really massively expand and make your worm castings go further is making the compost tea. And that basically will grow some of the biology in the castings. So you could just broadcast it, you know, on your garden. So I think the last question I have for you, Brian, is do you have any special offers that you'd like to share for my viewers that are watching this video today?
Well, since the first video, we got a lot of calls from people that watched the pepper video. And so what we've worked out is normally these bags are, the cubic foot is $29.95. And then the cheapest way that we found to be able to ship this is USPS in a keyboard box, and that's $18.85. So it's a lot of money. So what we've done is reduce that, so it's $40 for a cubic foot of worm castings.
Delivered,
right. And you know, if you call us, we do this all with PayPal, and generally the orders go out the same day. And you get it, they're saying within 2 days. Sometime, I mean, if you're farther, really far away, maybe it's 3 days. But so far, everybody's been getting them within 2 to 3 days.
Awesome, great. Yeah, that's definitely a good deal. I would also encourage you guys to check out boogiebrew.net/GYG. Josh comes down to pick up castings in bulk, and then he'll ship out to you guys with, you know, the OGS castings only, or the OGS castings with some of the other good castings out there. So, Brian, if somebody wants to learn more about your company, do you have a website and your contact information?
We do have a website, organicsolution.com, and it's singular. And that's got information on our products. And then you've got a phone number. And right now there is an email address on that webpage that says info@organicsolution.com. We have no idea where that's going because we are not getting anything. So if you want to send an email, send it to Brian, BRYAN@organicsolution.com, and we will respond. We're the office phone number rings to my cell. We respond to every phone call. So if you email, we respond to those. So give us a call.
All right, great. Well, that's pretty much it for the end of this episode. If you guys like this episode here at Organic Solution and want me to come back in the future, hey, give a thumbs up. If I get another 1,000 thumbs ups, which I hope I don't, I'll come again and even show you guys some more stuff that I didn't get to show you guys this time. There's so many things I could have showed you, and I only had a limited time here today. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes that are coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to check my past episodes, over 1,200 episodes now, and I'll put a link down below to that cool pepper video I did last year that shows the yield results when using the Organic Solution worm casting product. With that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.